Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us, whoever believes in him will live forever. Failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms, with his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Praise him, for the wonders of his love. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God.
Whoever believes in him will live forever.
cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Oh, let us give them a hand. That was such an amazing song. Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome here with us. We welcome you. We hope you feel very welcome. We also want to ask who is visiting us for the first time. If you can just please lift up your hand. We would just like to give you something and also to connect with you. So if you are here for the first time, please raise your hand. You just see there at the back, we have a few people. Welcome with us. Also here at the front, please keep your hand in the air. Thank you so much. Today we are welcoming Jan van Jaarsveld, who will bring the message today. The message is be removed and be cast into the sea, speaking to the mountains. So we are seeing forward to the message today. And I also want to invite you next week. Themba Malaba will be visiting us. He will be the preacher. He is from every nation. So we are welcoming next week, so please don't miss out. I also want to remind you about our Passover services. We will have our Good Friday service and our Resurrection Sunday service we will have in the Yellow Hall. So our Good Friday service will be 8:30, and our Resurrection Sunday is a sunrise service. So it is early. We will be meeting at 6 o'clock for those who would like to join us.
In the Yellow Hall, eh?
In the Yellow Hall, yes. Please make a note of that. We will not be in the Delta Auditorium on that day. Today we will also have cell groups and youth group, and our kids ministry is in the Yellow Hall. So if there are any children, you please need to go to the Yellow Hall. If you can also help us to please direct the children to the Yellow Hall. Today we will finish for the quarter. So next week the school holidays are starting, and we will only start again in April. The 7th of April we will start again with our children's ministry. So we are concluding today for the quarter, and I just want to ask you, if you come next week and you have children, let them please come with you to church, but they please must be under your supervision as well. So if every adult can please help us just to keep the kids in the sermon, that they are sitting and sitting quietly.
And maybe just to intervene, we do have the mother's room in the back as well, for those maybe that's not aware.
Yes. And then we please need more volunteers for our coffee ministry every Sunday, and also for our multimedia ministry. If you are able to use a computer and you are willing to receive some training, please come to us. You can speak to me or Quentin. We really need some people to help us at the multimedia ministry. Okay, so I'm going to pray for us now. I would just like to share a verse with us from Psalm 18, verse 35 to 36. And that's all also that I'm going to pray for us. It says, "You have given me your shield of victory. Your right hand supports me. Your help has made me great. You have made a wide path for my feet to keep them from slipping." So I'm going to pray for us now, and then I will give opportunity for tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Father, we want to worship you, and we want to give you all the glory and the honor. Lord, thank you that you are our shield of victory. Thank you that your right hand supports us. Lord, thank you that it is your help that makes us great. Lord, thank you that you are creating a wide path for our feet And Lord, thank you that you keep us from slipping. Lord, we come to you this morning and I want to bring everyone to you, Lord, that are in need of your help. Lord, thank you that you give us a Father's help this morning. I want to ask you, Lord, to move from chair to chair and to meet everyone in a personal way today. Lord, I pray for your provision where it is needed. Lord, I pray for healing where it is needed. Lord, we pray that as we come into your presence today, as we worship you, Lord, that all those chains will just fall off today. Come and meet us today, Lord, in your word. I pray, Holy Spirit, will you minister personally to each one of us. Lord, and I also pray that as we give this morning for your kingdom, Lord, we pray that you will bless it and that your kingdom will be expanded and that your will be done. We thank you, and we worship you, and I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You are most welcome to bring your tithes and offerings now to the front. Thank you, Quentin.
Thank you, Elise Marie. As you stand up, please join us as we sing the Lord's praises.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Sing with us.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God. Who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. In rainbows of living colors, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be. You are the only wise King. Praise to the King of Kings. You are the only, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, 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 is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are the only thing, and I will adore you.
Jesus is to be adored every single day, and it is our job to each and every morning be thankful and joyous in the gift of life. There are people who don't have that joy that we have, and every single morning I pray for them so that they may be saved and that they may have even just a glimpse of what we have in God. So let's take this song and just praise Him for who He is. He is our Father, our Savior, our Dad, that we may find everlasting love in Him. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Hey! I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. Oh, I raise a hallelujah. Lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. little louder.
Sing a 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 little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Heaven comes time, let's go, fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Oh, sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
Oh, I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder,
we gotta hear my praises roar.
Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Oh, I raise a hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
Oh,
I raise a hallelujah.
I raise a give yourselves a hand, guys. That was beautiful. Thank you so much.
Here I am, down on my knees again, surrendering all. Surrendering all. Find me there, Lord, as you draw me near, desperate for you, desperate for you. I surrender. Drench my soul, His mercy and grace unfold, hunger and thirst, hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry, speak to me now. Oh, speak to me now. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more.
Thank you very much to the praise and worship team. You may be seated. Good day, everyone. Welcome here in our fellowship as God's children together this morning at Moreleta Connect. Mamuka say. Okay, let us just pray as we would like to ask God's blessing and His presence in our sermon this morning. Father God, thank you for the privilege that we have as your children, that you care about us, that you want to meet with us, that we may come to your throne, that we may worship you, that we may pray to you and intercede for events, and that we may pray that you will release us also from challenges, that we may overcome it, and where there are things that you instruct us in your word that we should pray for, guide us, let us know what your will is for our lives and for our congregation. Be here through your Spirit and open our hearts and minds. It's when we open your word that you would be the one that speak to us and that we would listen and hear you clearly. Speak to each and every one of our hearts this morning, and may we implement what we learn from you. And it's also always through the power of your Spirit that dwells in us. We surrender all as we have just sung. We surrender so that you may lead us and we may hear your voice Guide us, protect us, be glorified here in our midst, in Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Okay, so we have started the year with a series on prayer. We normally do a week of prayer, and now we have entered the time that we called Lent, where we think of the suffering of our Lord Jesus. And last week we had the sermon, remember the crown with the small letters versus the crown with capital letters. And we celebrated also the crown of thorns, which Jesus bore with us at the cross. So we're in Passion Week, approaching Passion Week. This is today, the fifth Sunday in Lent. Next Sunday is actually Passion Sunday, and then the Sunday afterwards, of course, with a Passover weekend, it is Resurrection Sunday. It's Passover. So the text we are going to read today was taken from the final week, the Passion Week of Jesus Christ when he was here on earth. And actually, it was not maybe specifically intended to be a Passion Week sermon, but it is because it relates to prayer in times of suffering, even at the end today when we will apply this sermon to our lives. As you know me, I would like to do expository preaching on this text because it always helps us if we understand the context and what the message was for the original hearers. If we can understand and grasp that correctly, we will be able to apply it today in our lives also better. Now, the text we will read today, I'm of the opinion it's hardly ever understood in the church at large. So its meaning is a little bit obscured, and we need to go a little bit deeper, and it's my privilege to help and to be an instrument in God's hands to expose and bring us to understanding. It's, of course, the Holy Spirit that does that, and we are being led by Him. So we're still on the topic of prayer. But prayer also today in the context of spiritual warfare, actually in command of the Lord. And we will also see how we should work with Scripture. We always have to read the whole Bible and not only a single verse, because we may make a mistake. We need to see the bigger picture. We need to get the right context, and that will help us to come to interpret the passage and to come to the right understanding. We need to make, of course, effort and time and trust God's Spirit to lead us as we ponder on His Word. So let us read our main text. Maybe the second slide, let me just say something there. Our topic today, say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea. Now, there's the mountain with everything on it in the sea. So maybe you were wondering, what is this about? Let's go to read our passage, and then I'll explain, and hopefully we'll come to a better understanding. Next slide. Thank you, Johan. Mark 11, verse 20 to 25. Now, in the morning, as they passed by, so on the way to the temple to Jerusalem, Jesus and his disciples, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, remembering, said to him, Rabbi, look, the fig tree which you cursed has withered away. It was cursed just the previous day. So Jesus answered and said to him, have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Now, the cursing of the fig tree is the only destructive miracle that Jesus performed. All his miracles was quite edifying, healing the sick, etc., etc. Now, I want to point out something. The context here is the week, the Passion Week. And we will note that in this week, Jesus' teaching is much about the condemnation and the judgment that would be coming on that prison system. So bear that in mind. Normally, it's not destructive. And sometimes when we pray, we always pray positively, but we will see this morning that we need also to pray sometimes for judgment. But according to God's will, while we're forgiving, while we love people, hey. So I'm sure you have heard the saying, faith can move mountains. Faith can move mountains. And of course, it comes from this. But maybe it's not the most accurate description. Moving a mountain, but we read it is about removing this mountain. There's a huge difference. It's not moving a mountain, it's removing this mountain. So, let's explore. And also, faith is not the only criteria. There are people that makes a lot about faith on this passage. Maybe it's not exactly what the passage wants to communicate, that God wants to communicate to us. We will see. The deduction often made then is Christians can literally move a mountain, just need to have faith. Hey? But is this even speaking literally? Is it speaking of a literal mountain? Or what is this mountain and what is the fig tree a symbol of? What is this talking about? Now, you will also recall that Jesus often taught through parables. In other words, he's using pictures and telling stories to symbolize truths, things that he wants to illustrate. And many people didn't understand the parable. So the question is, why did Jesus use parables then to teach, if it's not always not obvious what he's trying to teach? Because, listen carefully, God wants us to seek him with all our heart, with all our being. If we would like, if we love him, if we from with the right attitude go to God, of course he would like us to understand. If we truly seek him, and he will reveal himself to us, to those that want to hear, those that want to love him, that want to get to know him better. So we need to think and listen carefully what he wants to say. And as we approach him, as we draw closer to him, he will draw closer to us. Hey. So, if your heart is hardened, like even the Pharisees in the Bible and the scribes, if your heart is hardened, the truth will be hidden from you. Not so. So, this is the first thing we need to want to know God better. And he will reveal himself to us. So we talked about figurative speech and symbolism. Let's go to John 6, verse 53. I want to illustrate that because there's a group of people among Christians that say, no, the Bible, you always need to take it literally. It's always exactly what it says, literally. But let the Bible speaks for itself. John 6, 53 to 56, and see if you can take this literally. Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. Well, this is not literal, that's obvious. But you know what? The previous day, Jesus broke the bread and he fed 5,000 men. There were actually more. That's only the men that were counted. There was maybe more than 10,000 people. If women and then children comes, maybe 12,000, 15,000, who knows. But then they came again the next day, and Jesus knew their hearts because they were there more for the physical food, the bread and the fish, than the spiritual food that he wanted to give them. So he told them this, and in their understanding, they understood this literally. And you can imagine that is not a nice thing to think, that you need to eat physically the body of Jesus. We know, of course, that he meant that he is the bread of life, the spiritual food that brings us life. Hey. So Luke and John 6, verse 60 and 66, just what I told many of those disciples of that 5,000, they heard this and they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can understand this?" From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. You see, they didn't seek Jesus, and now they were blind, not to come to understanding. They missed the symbol. They missed the figurative speech. So, one day, Jesus had a church of more than 5,000 people. The next day, only 12. But Jesus, the 12 that he had were jewels, and he built his church. We are there here because of those 12 that God used to build the church that time. So even if the numbers are not that great, if we are attached to God and we walk with him, he can do miracles through us. Hey. Okay, so Jesus then, John 6, 67 to 69, says to the 12, the little small church that remained after the big church they had the previous day, "Do you also want to go away?" Jesus told them. But Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Look at this confession and statement. No wonder God could use the small church to do mightier things than the big church. Not so. Okay. So Jesus worked with his disciples. They had some faith, and Jesus developed them further and took them even to deeper understanding. So now we also need to recognize that Jesus speaks in the passage that we read about the fig tree and this mountain. And those things are also symbolizing specific things, and we need to determine what that is. If we don't, we're not going to understand what Jesus is talking about, and let alone how can we then apply it in our lives today. Okay, let's read. We see that the Apostle Paul also used symbolic language, and he also used a mountain as a symbol. Let's go and see in Galatians 4, what Paul, how he is using. And he says it straightforward to us, which things are symbolic. Here it says, Paul says, he's speaking about the mountains, the two covenants, and he says, which things are symbolic? For these are the two covenants, the old and the new. The one from Mount Sinai, where the law was given in Arabia. Hey, and that woman, the bond woman, which gives birth to bondage, which is Hagar, that portrays the law. For Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is. This tells us that when Paul wrote this, Jerusalem was still standing. Because he says, which now is. And it's also the earthly Jerusalem. It was still there in Paul's time. And it's bondage with their children. Nevertheless, what does the scripture say? Cast out the bondwoman. Cast out the bondwoman and her son. So cast out Mount Sinai. Oh, here's a mountain that's casted away, casted out. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be the heir with the son of the free woman. Okay, so in general I can say mountains portray kingdoms. often in the Word, I can show you many verses, kings or kingdoms, but a mountain can stand for a kingdom, and Sinai Mountain here stood then for the bondage of the law of the Old Covenant, and it represented Jerusalem. But there's another Jerusalem above that is free, and that's God's new covenant people, and that was portrayed by Mount Zion, but the spiritual Mount Zion, not the physical one. We read that in Hebrews 12. The spiritual Mount Zion is the Christians. And that's a kingdom of course, a holy nation, Peter tells us, the kingdom of priests. So in order for us to get to the right symbolism of this mountain, let us go through this setting, see what was happening here. So I'm going to give a little bit context, not going to read it, it's not time enough, but just tell you the story, just what's happening here before and during this time. We said it's the Passion Week, and we can describe, I've said that Jesus in this time referred often to the judgment that was coming on Jerusalem. That is an important thing. So let's go and look at quickly the historical events. And in Mark 9, we saw that Jesus was still in Galilee, in Capernaum, in the north. In chapter 10, we see that he and the 12 were going south to Judea, at the other side of the Jordan first, in other words, east of the Jordan. In Mark 10, verse 32, we read that Jesus and the 12 now left the other side of the Jordan, and they were on their road to Jerusalem. And then, verse 33 of chapter 10, we read that Jesus announced his death. Behold, we are going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles. So here is popping up an enemy. The scribes and the chief priests, the religious people of that time, were going to oppose Jesus and the message and the kingdom and the disciples. Bear that in mind. In verse 46, they came to Jericho. And then they found there blind men, and specifically the blind Bartimaeus. And then they, when they were there at outside of Bethany, Jesus sent two of the disciples to Jerusalem. They fetched a donkey. They brought it to Jesus. And then on day one, this is when Passion Week starts. Jesus rode into Jerusalem with a donkey and the crowds of people shouting, "He is the Son of David, the Messiah." This is a unique, specific event of Passion Week. And that evening, Jesus came to the temple after he rode on the donkey into Jerusalem. We know it's also fulfillment of prophecy. And then he watched around in the temple, and we said it was late. So him and his disciples went again to Bethany. Most probably they slept over in Bethany during this time at Lazarus and Martha and Maria. They were friends of them. So now the Passover was approaching. And of course, there are many Jews from all over the world that came for the feast, for the Passover feast to Jerusalem. So it was crowded. Not only the Jerusalem or the Israel Jews, but Jews from the whole of the Roman Empire, the Jews that are spread over the whole empire. So they were there, and then of course there was a lot of trade in the outside court, and that was a problem, because the outside court of the temple was meant for all nations to go and pray there, to get closer to God. But then Jesus found the trade there, and then he addressed that. And there's also a symbolic action there. So the next day, it was then day two, after he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, they came again, and then Jesus addressed, like I've mentioned, he said, "My house shall be called the house for all nations. You made it a den of thieves." And that upset the enemy. The scribes and Pharisees were not very happy. They were not happy about that. And it's written here, they sought that they might destroy him. the scribes and the chief priests. But then on day two, while he was on the way to the temple, they came across the fig tree. And Jesus was looking for fruit on this fig tree, but there was not fruit. There was leaves. Leaves were promising. You expect fruit. Even in the pre-season, you expect fruit. But then Jesus cursed this fig tree. We read in that in 11:4. So, and he also says, no one is going to ever eat fruit from you again. But of course, Jesus is not having problems with plants and so forth. It's not about this tree, about the plant. It's about what it stands for. And now we need to look and search. What does this fig tree stand for? Let's go to Luke 13, verse 6 to 9. Now, here's a parable. Jesus spoke this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. Does it sound familiar? Hey, this is exactly what Jesus found when he came there. Hey. Then he said to the keeper of his vineyard, look, for 3 years I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree and I found none. Cut it down. Why does it use up the ground? But he answered and said to him, sir, let it alone this year also until I dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit, well, but if not, after that you can cut it down. Can you see? Do you know what time of ministry, what length of time the ministry of Jesus was while he was on earth? 3.5 years. So, for 3 years, he nourished this fruit tree. He was reaching out to get the fig tree to bear fruit. And then there was one more, the last chance, that last 6 months of his ministry. He still was trying to get the fig tree to bear fruit. Can you see that Israel is the fig tree in this context? And the fruit that Jesus was looking for, we read in Isaiah 5, it's like righteousness. Things that God expects from his children. Today we're speaking about the fruit of the Spirit in our time. Hey, we know love and kindness and friendliness, long-suffering, all those things, fruit of the Spirit. But he was looking for fruit. He looked for fruit. He didn't find. But you can see the fig tree, according to this parable, it's undeniable. In this context, it's Israel. And we can say the apostate Israel, the part of Israel that was unfaithful, that part that didn't bear fruit. So the fig tree was going to cut down, and when Jesus cursed the fig tree, it was a symbolic act that this fig tree will dry, it will become dead, it will never, never, never bear fruit again, not even today. It won't bear fruit again. Doesn't bear fruit means it won't also be used by God as a light to the nations anymore. It won't be part of God's ministry plan. There's now a new covenant. The old covenant has passed. Okay, so now we see this Israel, the fig tree, they killed the Messiah, their Messiah, and they killed the prophets and apostles. And that's why God is going to judge them. No, okay. So having judged this fig tree, Jesus went to the temple. And then we know what happened in the temple. He got rid of the traders there. And he cleansed the temple. But that is in itself is also a symbol that the Jews will be cast out of the temple when judgment comes to them. Bear that also in mind. So even in itself, it's a cleansing, but it's also symbolic, a prophecy. So the next morning on day 3, then they came, and then the passage that we read, we saw the fig tree has withered, completely dried up, and Peter was surprised. Why was Peter surprised? He saw many miracles. He couldn't be surprised just because it's a miracle. He must have realized what this prophecy is all about. He knew that the fig tree portrayed Israel. And so And he knew also that this is the opposition, this is the enemy. And Jesus prophesied that the enemy will be removed, will get rid of. Okay, so now when Peter pointed out in astonishment about the dried fig tree, he said, look, check that. This is, wow. Is this going to be like this? And watch the reply of Jesus. He says, have faith in God. Now, not faith that we should curse fig trees, but faith that we trust God. If he says now the fig tree is going to be removed and we suffer because of the fig tree for still some years to come, we need to remember it will, the judgment will come. We need to trust God. We need faith is to trust God and to be faithful. So, in the symbolic act, the fig tree died, but in the real life, the fig tree still stood there. Israel was still there and was still going to persecute the Christians for some time. As a matter of fact, I can tell you exactly how long it lasted. It took 40 years. 40 years before the judgment came. Okay. But now God says that they should pray for the judgment to come. Now, that sounds funny for us. We love people. We love our enemies. We forgive our enemies. Why should we pray for God's judgment to come? Because the kingdom of God, we pray, let your kingdom come. And that implies that obstacles for the kingdom to expand must be removed. Even though if we don't hate people in personally attacking us, but for the sake of God's kingdom, we need to pray for God's righteousness to prevail. Let's look Matthew 23, what Jesus tells the fig tree. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! Therefore you are witnesses against yourselves that you are the sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of your father's guilt. Serpents, brother vipers, how can you escape the condemnation of Gehenna? Therefore indeed I sent you prophets, wise men and scribes. Those are the apostles, the wise men and the scribes. They are sent to Jerusalem, and some of them you kill and crucify, even Jesus the Messiah himself. And some of them you will scourge in your synagogues and persecute from city to city, that on you may come. Look, listen to this judgment. On you may come all the righteous blood shed in the land, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Assuredly, I say you, all these things will come upon this generation. That generation in Jesus' time will see the judgment coming on them because of the murdering of the Old Testament prophets and even now the apostles and so forth. So, Jesus prophesied judgment on the fig tree, and that judgment will come before that generation has run out. So, Jesus now is telling them with this symbolic act to have faith in God, that that promise will be fulfilled. The fig tree is going to persecute them still, and they will have suffering and so forth, but they may pray for its judgment. God is building his kingdom, so he removes obstacles in the way. Okay, so now, still on this topic, while we're still here, let's remember that there was a clause that say for, and linking the different parts, we will show you now. Now we get to wherever says to this mountain. Can you see that there is a link between the fig tree and this mountain? We will show you in a while, but I first want to have a similar scripture with a similar message. And this time, it's the adversary of a widow, the enemy that giving a widow a lot of problems. We read in Luke 18, and this is similar. It's just another image, another symbol tells us the same story. So Jesus again spoke in a parable, and that they should pray, continue to pray, not lose heart, and saying, in a certain city, there was a judge, and would not fear God, nor regard man, was a normal, humanly judge. There was a widow in that city, and she came saying, get justice from me, for me. She approached the judge and said, I want justice. So it's a prayer for justice, for vengeance. And the judge, didn't take care, wouldn't do something. But she continued to pray. She continued to pray for justice until this human judge. So, this woman is just troublesome. Let me avenge her. And then God said, how much more will He, the righteous God, as our judge, also avenge His children when they cry out to Him? And now, again, this widow is persecuted, and this portray exactly the same. The city is Jerusalem. The widow is the Christians. They're crying out for justice because the Jews are persecuting them. The fig tree is bothering them. In the end, it took 40 years, but justice came in. God answered that prayer. He will bear long with them. But we need to continue to pray and not get disheartened. So, before this generation, Jesus promised judgment will come. Revelation 6, another scenario of the same, of God's children crying out for justice. Now I'll give you the context. I saw under the altar of the temple, this portray a Jewish system. And these are Jewish Christians. The souls of those had been slain for the word of God and for their testimony. They had the eyewitness of Jesus. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell in the land? And then Jesus told them, wait a little longer. A little longer. You know, when John saw this vision, it was only 2 years, 2 to 3 years, when that judgment came. A little longer. So this is the same scenario. The Jewish Christians were persecuted in Israel from 30 to 70 AD. Okay, so let's move again to our text, and I see our time is ferociously running out on us. Mark 11, in the morning, we reread it. I just want to show you the connections. The fig tree dried from its roots. Peter said to him, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered away. Can you see the links? So, Jesus answered, because of that, Jesus answered, have faith in God. And then for assuredly, linking this to the previous, say to this mountain, because of the fig tree that was cursed, say to this mountain, be removed. Therefore, I say to you, these are all linked. They are tied up with conjunction, words of conjunctions to one another. So, let's get now to closer to the mountain. Okay. So, we remember even in the time of Abraham, how he was promised a son born of Sarah. Sarah was very old, and then they had to wait 10, 20 years. And they got a little bit uneasy about this promise. But in the end, God answered the prayer 20 years later. And even in this scenario, God was going to answer, even if it at first doesn't look like that. Now, okay. They were standing there at Bethany, next to the fig tree. Get to the next slide. They're standing there next to the fig tree. And what is behind them? There's a mountain there, right? What is on the mountain? The city of Jerusalem. Okay, now what is the thing that we must say about Jerusalem? The temple is there, but also the headquarters of the Jewish system, that apostate system, the Pharisees, the persecutors. That's a symbol of the persecution of the Christians. So as the fig tree was cursed and removed, symbolically, They need to pray for the removal of that system that is oppressing the Christians. Pray for the removal of the mountain. The mountain is the kingdom. This kingdom is the apostate Jerusalem. We can go to the next slide. This mountain, not any mountain, this mountain must be removed. And now, where is it taking to? The sea. What's the sea a symbol of? I can show you, there's no time now. A sea always, often, is a symbol for the Gentile nations. So take this mountain, throw them into the Gentile nations. What's going to happen? Apostate Israel is going to be removed. I will show you another slide where they actually are taken to the Gentiles. We're getting to there. I'm just now summarizing, but the time is running. So we remember also Daniel, and Daniel 10 had to pray. He read Jeremiah 25, the promise of God that Israel will return from Babylon out of exile back to Jerusalem. And when he read that, he said, okay, what is the conditions? Okay, we must confess. And then he fell on his knees and he prayed. He said, Father, forgive us on behalf of Israel. And then it happened. Even though it was prophesied, God still wanted to use us to pray so that it will happen. In Daniel's case, it was a good illustration. So, now we are almost, we're getting approaching the end of our sermon, but now we still need to finish this mystery. So the mountain was indeed cast into the sea. Did you know that? The one is the Bible tells us so, but history also tells us so. So, the million-dollar question, who can tell me, where does the Bible tell us that this mountain was thrown into the sea? Using the same symbol. Any idea? You will be surprised. Let's get a drum roll there. I'm going to announce it. Special moment. Where does the Bible tell us this mountain was? So the Christians did pray, and it did happen. It did happen. Drum roll. Trrr, doof. Okay. If you can't get the drum roll, just play it. Okay. The drum roll there was a little bit too soft. But okay, there it is. Revelation 8 verse 8. Read what it says. Then the second angel sounded, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea. There it is. And this was the vision that John saw was, I've said, just 2 to 3 years before it happened. Can you see, and why? With fire. What is the symbol telling us? Fire is judgment. Judgment. God's judgment. That mountain was removed. The Christians prayed. So, but the second way we may know is history. Let's go. We need to quickly wrap up. Slide 28. There is what happened to Jerusalem in the year 70 AD. The Roman armies came and destroyed Jerusalem. The temple was burned down. And we read that, the next slide in the book, Flavius Josephus, the history writer, The Wars of the Jews. And the next slide, this is a monument of the Titus in Rome. There you can see how they carry the temple away, the candlesticks. This was actually stone capturing in Rome. But there is the slide that tells you the casting of the mountain into the sea, into the Gentile nations. Okay, so we need to just also say, therefore I say you, whatever things you pray, believe, and you will receive them. Is this a blank check? Can we just pray anything? In this case, we know that God promised something that they had to pray for. And we pray, let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Let your will be done. Of course, the same with our prayer. Go to the next slide, 1 John 5:14. It's not a blank. It's not about our faith. There are many things that cooperate with prayer. One thing is we ask anything according to His will. So I can't stand still now with these things. We need to wrap up. God is speaking to us, and He tells us, Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed with lack of knowledge. We need to read with understanding what God's Word is telling us. The Word, the knowledge comes from God's Word and the guidance of His Spirit. Let's summarize and apply. Now today we are also in a circumstances that there are challenges. There are corruption in government, things like that. Of course, God doesn't want that. We as Christians must pray against that. The removal of wrong systems, even if it takes years. We need not to stop praying. In our own lives, God's promises can materialize. James 4, we do not have because we do not ask. And sometimes if we ask not rightly, we ask selfishly. We need to pray according to God's will. We need to, next slide, Luke 9. We need to seek and discover what is God's will. We need to read and study His Word, but also to let go of our own will, to seek God's will, to deny ourselves, to take up our cross and follow them, to love our King and submit to Him. Then 2 Timothy, all Scripture is granted by God. We need to know what God wants us to do. What is the kingdom that we need to work for? What it is looking like? We need to study Scripture, reading it in this way. And we remember the last slide. If we study God's Word, if we read the Bible correctly and we can apply it correctly, God opens the Scripture and look here on the way to Emmaus. Did not our heart burn within us while He talked with us on the road, while He opened Scriptures to us? As far as I am serving God, I would like to be used by God to bring us to better understanding of the Word, because we can grow closer to Him. We can work against the forces of darkness, pray against this, so we can ask that God removes these obstacles that prevent us from building His kingdom. Amen. Thank you. Let me just do a short prayer. Father, we thank You for helping us to understand Your Word. Pray that we apply this in our lives, that we seek Your Scriptures, and we are diligently making effort to know what You are telling us. Thank You so much. Be with us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Jan. So now, what I take away from this is that in my personal life, there are things that might hinder me from connecting with God in a deeper way. And in a similar way that the symbolic mountains and the physical mountains be cast into the sea, let us pray that whatever keeps us away from God's grace and God's love, that may be cast into the sea as well. So in that, I ask you to stand. And this last song, let's sing as our anthem as we go out into the week and touch people's lives. And that may bring us closer to His love.
Singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, send us with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, send us with fire and love for the world. Singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, fill us with fire and love for the world. are gathered in your name with expectancy and faith. We are waiting. We are waiting. Give us boldness to proclaim all the wonders of your grace. We are ready. We are ready. Sing it. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts. Send us with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts. Fill us with fire and love for the world. Your compassion for the lost, love that sent you to the cross. We receive it. We receive it. Jesus, you are worth it all. No matter what the cost, we believe it. We believe it. Singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts. Send us with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts. Fill us with fire and love for. Let's sing it again. Singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, send us with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, fill us with fire and love for the world. This room is shaking. Let our hearts be broke. Let this church awake to your love. Let this room be shaken. Church awaken to your love. Let this room be shaken. Let our hearts be broken. Let the church awaken to your love. With power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, fill us with power. The world singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, send us with power into the world. Spirit, move in our hearts, fill us with fire. Love for the world, singing, oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, send us with power into the world. Oh, Holy Spirit, move in our hearts, fill us with fire.
So, during Passion Week, during Passion Week, we think of the suffering of Christ. We need also to know that Christ still suffers today, because we are the body of Christ and we suffer for various reasons. And we pray also against and for God to achieve his purpose against that suffering. I don't know what's wrong with the sound now. I put it on. Now, God willing, before I say the benediction next week, Themba Malaba from Zimbabwe will be here preaching, and he will speak on suffering and God's purpose and allowing of suffering, and it will also link to Christ's suffering, to our suffering, and to Passion Week. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Go and proclaim this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.